That's not an easy question to answer, but let's try. With the help of a curiously worded apology published by the Sunday Times in December 2013. What was this apology and how did it come about? The BBC Crime Watch programme, which we'll examine shortly, went out on the 14th of October 2013. The EFITs, apparently produced by Henry Exton, were the highlight of the entire broadcast. Exton, it seems, was incensed and complained to the Sunday Times. Here's part of the original Sunday Times article published on the 27th of October, less than 2 weeks after the Crime Watch McCann special. Madeleine Clues Hidden for 5 Years. The new prime suspect was first singled out by detectives in 2008. Their findings were suppressed. The critical new evidence at the centre of Scotland Yard's search for Madeleine McCann was kept secret for 5 years, after it was presented to her parents by ex-MI5 investigators. The evidence was in fact taken from an intelligence report produced for Gerry and Kate McCann by a firm of former spies in 2008. It contained crucial EFITs of a man seen carrying a child on the night of Madeleine's disappearance, which have only this month become public after he was identified as the prime suspect by Scotland Yard. A team of hand-picked former MI5 agents had been hired by the McCanns to chase a much-needed breakthrough in the search for their missing daughter Madeleine. A report produced by the investigators was deemed hypercritical of the McCanns and their friends, and the authors were threatened with legal action if it was made public. Its contents remained secret until Scotland Yard detectives conducting a fresh review of the case contacted the authors and asked for a copy. They found that it contained new evidence about a key suspect seen carrying a child away from the McCann's holiday apartment on the night Madeleine disappeared. This sighting is now considered the main lead in the investigation. EFITs taken from the report were the centrepiece of a Crime Watch appeal that attracted more than 2,400 calls from the public this month. One of the investigators, Henry Exton, whose work was sidelined, said last week he was utterly stunned when he watched the programme and saw the evidence his team had passed to the McCanns 5 years ago presented as a breakthrough. Exton said they had focused on the Smith sighting, travelling to Ireland to interview the family and producing EFITs of the man they saw. Their report said the Smiths were helpful and sincere and concluded the Smith sighting as credible evidence of a sighting of Maddie. Their report was delivered to the McCanns in November 2008. This report by the Sunday Times Insight team was very clear. Exton was saying that the Smiths were credible people. They helped him to draw up 2 EFITs. The McCanns knew about these EFITs before November 2008 and were handed a report about the EFITs in November 2008. Yet, said the Sunday Times, the McCanns had done nothing about it for a whole 5 years. It was a serious accusation, much too serious for the McCanns to ignore. They sued the Sunday Times for what they said was a gross libel of them. This led to a small and very curiously worded apology printed some weeks later by the Sunday Times. Let's now look at exactly what it said. In articles dated October 27, Madeleine Clues Hidden for 5 Years and Investigators Had EFITs 5 Years Ago, we referred to EFITs which were included in a report prepared by private investigators for the McCanns and the Fund in 2008. We accept that the articles may have been understood to suggest that the McCanns had withheld information from the authorities. This was not the case. We now understand and accept that the EFITs had been provided to the Portuguese and Leicestershire police by October 2009. This apology was not enough for the McCanns. They carried on with their libel action, eventually forcing the Sunday Times to pay them £55,000 damages, plus of course their legal costs. The one factual statement we are interested in is this. The McCanns claim that they provided these EFITs to the Portuguese and Leicestershire police by October 2009. Exton, as quoted in the Sunday Times, said he handed the report to the McCanns in November 2008. No doubt he would have told them about the EFITs as soon as he had produced them much earlier in the year. After all, the McCanns were paying him and the serial fraudster Kevin Halligan for his work. The McCanns say they provided the e-fits to the Portuguese police. Why have they not given us the actual date they did this? The same applies to their claim to have handed these e-fits to Leicestershire police. On what date did they do this? It seems they haven't told us. Also, the Times uses the curious phrase that they sent these e-fits by October 2009. This could mean anything. It could mean that they sent them a year earlier, or it could mean that they waited until the last day of October 2009 to do so. Why do we not get a clear, open answer from them? What we can draw from this is that the McCanns may indeed have sat on these e-fits, that is, withheld them from the police for about 18 months. The e-fits were probably produced in around April 2008, but only by October 2009, 18 months later, it seems, had they provided these e-fits to the two police forces. Why did they delay passing this apparently vital information to the police at all? So what happened to the two e-fits after they handed them in to the police? If they were handed to the Portuguese police and Leicestershire police as claimed, neither police force deemed them worthy of consideration. They did nothing, and neither did the McCanns. The next thing we know about the e-fits is the McCanns claim that the e-fits were passed to Operation Grange, the Scotland Yard team reviewing the Madeleine McCann case shortly after it was set up in May 2011. My next task is to explain why the head of Operation Grange, Detective Chief Inspector Andy Redwood, also did nothing with these e-fits until they were presented to an audience of some 7 million people on the BBC Crime Watch McCann special some 2.5 years later. Why a further delay of 2.5 years? I will explain this in a moment, but first let's get back to our general theme of how the McCanns have made use of the Smith sighting. So far, I have identified 5 phases of the Smith man's sighting. Here they are again. Now to phases 6 and 7. Phase 6 of the Smith sighting ran from June 2009 to April 2011. This is the period during which the McCanns actively promoted the Smith sighting on their Find Madeleine website. Then, when Dr. Kate McCann published her book Madeleine on the 11th of May 2011, Phase 7 began. The further promotion of Smith man's sighting on 7 pages of her book. Let's now briefly examine these 2 phases. The sighting by an Irish family was uploaded to the McCann's Find Madeleine website immediately after the 2009 Channel 4 documentary. An Irish voice was heard explaining the sighting with the following words.
I was with my family. We'd been out for the night.
After leaving a bar, we took the back way up some steps. We turned off this street and up another street. I'm not sure of its name.
We were walking up this street when I saw a man and he was carrying a child. I thought they were father and daughter, so I wasn't so suspicious.
He was walking down the street in the opposite direction to us.
The girl was about 4. She looked like my granddaughter, blonde hair, pale white skin, typically British. The man didn't look like a tourist. I can't explain why. It was probably from his clothes.
I only really saw the man when we passed each other. He was white, about 175 or 1.8 metres tall, perhaps 34 or 35 years old. He was slim to normal build, with short brown hair. He didn't wear glasses, moustache or a beard. I can't recall what he was wearing, apart from a pair of beige trousers. The girl was wearing light-coloured pyjamas. She was uncovered, no blanket or throw. Some of my family remember her having bare feet. He was carrying the girl over his arms, with her head against his left shoulder. He looked a bit uncomfortable in the way he carried her. This followed the wording of Martin Smith's initial statement very closely, except for one curious thing. In his witness statement, he had said that the man was about 35 to 40 years old. Now this statement says he was perhaps 34 or 35 years old. Why is the age more precise? This new estimate of the man's age as 34 to 35 also appears in Kate McCann's book, 2 years later. We can see here that Martin Smith's original statement has been adapted, maybe to make it appear more credible. We wonder how much did Martin Smith actively cooperate in the making of this Channel 4 documentary and his message being put on the McCann's website. He was and is a potential witness in this case. He must presumably have been asked for permission to place his sighting on the McCann's website. was he asked to allow the documentary makers to change his statement about the man's age from 35 to 40 to 34 to 35. If so, when did Martin Smith agree to this? Why was the statement changed, and who made the decision to change it? These are important questions which remain unanswered. What would happen if he was put in the witness box and a barrister put this to him? Mr. Smith, you told the police the man you saw was 35 to 40 years old. Why and when did you change your mind about this? So we've had a look at phase 6. Now what about phase 7? The further promotion of the Smith man sighting on 7 pages of Kate McCann's book. If we look through Kate McCann's book, we see several clear references to Smith man. Page 98. We subsequently learned that less than 50 minutes after Jane's sighting, when I still had to discover that Madeleine was missing, a family of 9 from Ireland had also seen a man carrying a child, this time on Rua de Escola Primaria, a few minutes' walk from apartment 5A, heading towards Rua 25 de Abreu. Their description was remarkably similar to Jane's. The man was in his mid-30s, 1.75 to 1.8 metres tall, and of slim to normal build. These witnesses, too, said this person didn't look like a tourist. They felt it might have been because of what he was wearing. They also mentioned cream or beige trousers. The child, a little girl about 4, with medium blonde hair, lying with her head towards the man's left shoulder. She was wearing light-coloured pyjamas, had nothing on her feet, and there was no blanket over her. The man did not look comfortable carrying the child, as if he wasn't used to it. In this short paragraph, Kate calls the two descriptions remarkably similar, and mentions as many as 11 distinct similarities. It is clear that Kate is suggesting that Smith man was a genuine sighting, and probably the same man seen by Jane Tanner. Again on pages 328 and 329, Smith man is referred to, and Kate now suggests it is the same man. Quote, who knows why there was a 45-minute gap between the two sightings, or where this man might have been in between. I have long ago stopped trying to come up with answers, because I don't think I need to. If the child was Madeleine, and in 4 years no father has ever come forward to say it was him and his daughter, why would we assume that he was behaving normally or logically? There is nothing normal about stealing a little girl from her bed, so why should his subsequent actions be predictable? She goes on to speculate. The abductor would hardly have been expecting to see Jane walking towards him as he escaped, let alone have anticipated that Jerry would be standing talking around the corner. Whatever plan was in his mind, he might very well have been forced by these near misses to change it pretty quickly. Then finally, on pages 370 to 372, we get a direct comparison from Kate between Jane Tanner's Tanner man and Martin Smith's Smith man. Kate McCann is right to say that the similarities are striking. The only description that differs significantly is in the colour and the length of the man's hair. There is one curious statement she makes in her book, though, page 371. She says that Jane saw a man 5'10" in height, 1.78 metres, making the man the same height as Smith man. But if you look at Tanner's statement, it indicates that the man was only 1.7 metres tall, which would make him only 5'7". Why the change of about 3 inches? Kate says in her book, the man's height was recorded incorrectly in her, meaning Jane Tanner's, statement. How does she know this? So we have seen in phases 6 and 7 how the McCanns made significance of the Smith man's sighting. People bought her book and read about Smith man. People kept visiting the McCann's website and heard the Irish family's account of the sighting. But now we move on to the most vital new phase in the development of the Smith sighting. Phase 8, Operation Grange gets the Smith man e-fits and spends over 6 months planning a BBC programme to promote them. We know, as it's been admitted by the McCanns and Operation Grange, that very early on in the history of Operation Grange, the McCanns handed the e-fits to the senior investigating officer, DCI Andy Redwood. Operation Grange, based at Belgravia Police Station, was set up in May 2011, when Prime Minister David Cameron was pressurised by Rebecca Brooks, the chief executive officer of Rupert Murdoch's News International Empire, to set it up. We can assume that DCI Redwood had these two e-fits by the summer of 2011. One news report said it was August 2011. they were finally shown to the British public on a BBC Crime Watch show on the 14th of October 2013, over 2 years later. Why the delay? I suggest two reasons. First, DCI Redwood couldn't use the Smithman eFits until he had solved the problems created by the sighting by Jane Tanner. There were two main problems with it. It was not credible. There were numerous indications that it was fabricated. And, as we've just seen, how could you possibly explain a man walking around a small town for 45 minutes with a child you've just abducted? You couldn't. The second reason for the delay could be that he may have needed to have Martin Smith's cooperation with any broadcast about him on Crime Watch, especially as the Crime Watch McCann special was to be the most hyped Crime Watch show ever. We know on the record that DCI Redwood had two interviews with Martin Smith, one in 2012 and one in 2013, as the Crime Watch programme was being planned. We don't know if these meetings took place by DCI Redwood going to Ireland or Martin Smith flying to London. We don't know if any other members of the Smith family were present at these two meetings. What we can be almost sure about is that DCI Redwood would have discussed with Martin Smith the two eFits he now had in his possession, and one would assume Redwood would have shared with Martin Smith exactly what he was going to say about the Smith sighting on the Crime Watch programme. Strangely, although DCI Redwood made a huge deal of the eFits and made reference to the sighting by an Irish family, he did not actually say on Crime Watch that the Smiths produced the eFits. I'll come to that in a moment. Back in July 2008, when Dr. Amaral published his book, The Truth of the Lie, he was persuaded that the Smiths had honestly described their sighting. He also tended to believe Martin Smith when he claimed to have recognised Jerry McCann as possibly the man he'd seen carrying a child on the 3rd of May. But now we've seen how the McCann team became involved, and how by the first few months of 2009 they were already making use of the sighting. Then in 2011, in her book, we saw how in a number of sections of her book Madeleine, she openly suggested that the men Jane Tanner and Martin Smith said they saw were one and the same. Smithman was being actively used by the McCann team. Gonçalo Amaral had believed that Smithman might well be Jerry McCann, but now the McCanns were strongly suggesting he was the abductor. And now we move on to consider the last phase of Smithman, Phase 9, October 2013, Smithman revealed by Scotland Yard as the chief suspect. Let's now look at the relevant part of the transcript of the BBC Crime Watch McCann special on the 14th of October 2013.
Madeleine and her siblings, Sean and Amelie, were staying in the front bedroom, which looked out onto the front car park. Madeleine was in a bed and the two children were in travel cots between Madeleine's bed and the bed that was nearest to the window. The careful and critical analysis of the timeline has been absolutely key. Primarily, we're focused on the area between 8:30 and 10. We know that at 8:30, that was the time that Mr. and Mrs. McCann went down to the tapas area for their dinner, and we know that at around 10 p.m. that was when Mrs. McCann found that Madeleine was missing.
One of the most pivotal events on the timeline was Jane Tanner's sighting of a man carrying a child.
He was walking in this spot, just metres from where Madeleine had been sleeping. This man was widely thought to be Madeleine's abductor, but the team was taking nothing for granted.
One of the things that we picked up very quickly was the fact that there was a night creche that was operating from the main Ocean Club reception, and eight families had left 11 children in there. And one particular family we spoke to gave us information that was really interesting and exciting. In fact, I would say it was a revelation moment when, having discussed with them what they were doing on the night, they themselves believed that they could be the Tanner sighting.
The British father had collected his two-year-old daughter from the creche. He had been walking near the McCann's apartment. This is the actual photograph taken by Metropolitan Police officers of the man dressed in the kind of clothes he wore on holiday. This image was compared to the artist's impression.
It is uncannily similar, and we know the pajamas that their child was wearing, that it is, again, uncannily striking, the similarity.
So what you're saying is that the timeline that everyone was working on for years in this case was wrong.
We're almost certain now that this sighting is not the abductor. But very importantly, what it says is that from 9:15, we're able to allow the clock to continue to move forward. And in doing so, things that have not been quite as significant or received quite the same degree of attention are now the centre of our focus.
This was an enormous discovery for the team. An innocent explanation for the suspect who'd been at the centre of the case for 6 years. Their attention quickly turned to another sighting, which could now be the key to the entire mystery.
It was here at 10 p.m. that an Irish family witnessed another man carrying a child. They saw him come down the hill from the direction of the Ocean Club, heading that way towards the beach. Could this have been Madeleine and her abductor?
So, Redwood had effectively claimed to the British nation that he had traced, identified and eliminated the chief suspect, Tanner Mann. He was almost certain, he told Crime Watch viewers. What now? Then, as we saw, Redwood came up with another bombshell. His chief suspect was now Smith Mann, the man the Irish family said they had seen. And he produced two e-fits of the suspect. Here they are. But when Crime Watch showed us these two e-fits, Redwood appears to have been guilty of some cunning sleight of hand. Let's just listen carefully to the actual words used on Crime Watch.
It was here at 10 p.m. that an Irish family witnessed another man carrying a child. They saw him come down the hill from the direction of the Ocean Club, heading that way towards the beach. Could this have been Madeleine and her abductor?
He was a white man with brown hair, and the child that he had in his arms was described as being about 3 to 4 years of age, with blonde hair, possibly wearing pajamas. A description very close to that of Madeleine McCann.
Two of the witnesses helped create e-fits of the man they saw. Today, for the first time, we can reveal the true significance of these images.
This could be the man that took Madeleine, but very importantly, there could be an innocent explanation. The e-fits are clear.
Notice that presenter Amrullah Waller does not actually say that these two e-fit images were produced by the Smith family. He refers, for some reason, only to the two witnesses. Then he says that the two e-fits of the man are clear. But most people who have looked at these two images suggest that they look to be images of two entirely different people. Moreover, computer experts have analysed the two images and consider that the two images have been produced on different e-fit computer programs. One image is grainy, the other is sharper. If they were, as claimed, drawn up by two members of the Smith family, why do they look like they were generated using different software? But still more relevant, why, if we are looking for just one man, do we get two images which, to most people, look like quite different blokes? The man on the left, when compared to the man on the right, has a fat face, has a rectangular-shaped face, the man on the right has a triangular-shaped face, his curly hair brushed back, unlike the crew cut of the man on the right, he has thicker lips, has a shortish, flattish nose compared with the long, thin nose of the man on the right. It is highly unusual for the police to show two different e-fits of one man they are really looking for. It's even more unusual for a pair of e-fits to reveal so many different features. Why did the police not get the Smiths to come up with one composite e-fit of the man they said they desperately wanted to trace? But on top of that is the question of how an e-fit could have been constructed, bearing in mind the Smiths' initial statements. They only saw him for a few seconds, it was dark, the street lighting was weak, they all said that the child covered the man's face. so they couldn't see what he looked like. Each of them told the police explicitly that they would not be able to recognize the man if they saw him again. Here are the statements made by each of the Smiths about the man they said they saw. He did not wear glasses and had no beard or mustache. He did not notice any other relevant details, partly due to the fact that the lighting was not very good. He did not notice the body clothing and cannot describe the colour or fashion of the same. It is not possible for him to recognise the individual in person or by photograph. He does not remember if he wore glasses or had a beard or moustache. He did not notice any other relevant details as the lighting was bad. He also does not remember the clothing the individual wore or his shoes. He states that he did not notice those details. What we had seen was so vague that we couldn't identify the guy. At the time we saw his face, but now cannot remember it. She thinks that he had a clean-shaven face. States that probably she would not be able to recognize either the individual or the child. Bearing in mind these statements, how could any e-fits realistically have been produced? In my email to Martin Smith on the 21st of January 2015, I wrote, "Dear Martin, I am continuing to research the events surrounding the Madeleine McCann case, and I would like to ask you if you would do an interview for a possible TV film. I am led to believe that the e-fits, which were featured on Crimewatch UK in October 2013, were both derived from yours and or members of your family's descriptions of the man you saw. There is some confusion about these e-fits, not least the fact that they were never released until 5 years after they were produced. Would you be willing to be interviewed just to clear up what the sequence of events was after you had the sighting? If you are unable to do an interview, can you tell me in an email, 1, who asked you to do the e-fits, 2, which organisation drew the e-fits, 3, when were the two e-fits done and were they done at the same time and place, 4, which person in your family was the witness for each of the e-fits, 5, did you expect the e-fits to be made public when you made them, 6, did you think it strange that they were not made public? To date, I have had no response from Martin Smith. Now let's move on to consider the blurry image of the man allegedly found by DCI Andy Redwood, the man said to be carrying a child home from the creche, the man, so DCI Redwood told Crimewatch viewers, who was the man Jane Tanner really saw. The first point we might ask is, where had he been for the last 6.5 years? He was allegedly in Praia da Luz at the time. He must have been fully aware of all the publicity about Madeleine. He must have known that Jane Tanner had claimed to have seen a man carrying a child near apartment 5A at exactly 9:15 p.m. He probably saw or was at least aware of all the documentaries about Madeleine, all the news items, the TV interviews by the McCanns on such programmes as Oprah Winfrey and Piers Morgan. To say the least, this raises a major question about the validity of DCI Redwood's claims about this unnamed man suddenly having come forward after 6.5 years. Let's look back for a moment exactly what the Crimewatch programme told us about this man who'd suddenly contacted DCI Redwood.
One particular family we spoke to gave us information that they themselves believed that they could be the Tanner sighting.
The British father had collected his two-year-old daughter from the creche. He had been walking near the McCann's apartment.
Crimewatch also told us that in the blurred photograph of him, the man was dressed in the kind of clothes he wore on holiday. Not only that, but we were told that his two-year-old daughter was wearing pyjamas that were uncannily, strikingly similar. The coincidences are simply amazing. But let's also consider this. DCI Redwood speaks of a family being on holiday. It's reasonable to assume that the man's wife or partner, the child's mother, was with him on holiday. Where was she when this man was allegedly carrying this toddler back to his holiday apartment? Why did he not have a buggy or a pushchair? Why did he not have a coat, blanket or warm outer clothing for the child? We are simply being asked to take on trust from Scotland Yard that this man who comes forward after 6.5 years really exists. Do you believe him? There is surely room for doubt, and that doubt was shared publicly by one of the most respected workers with children, child psychologist and former state prosecutor Wendy Murphy, a lady who had studied the Madeleine McCann case in depth. Here she is on Fox News giving her opinion on Scotland Yard's attempts to find yet another mystery abductor in the case.
Help solve the mystery of what happened to Madeleine McCann. She, of course, is the 3-year-old British girl who disappeared while on vacation more than 6 years ago. Now Scotland Yard is planning to release a new computerized sketch that shows a possible suspect. Wendy Murphy is a former prosecutor and a child advocate. She joins us now. Hi, Wendy.
Good to be with you.
Finally, 6 years later, investigators are releasing a computerized sketch of who they call basically a person of interest, a suspect that people saw around the vacation condo that night. What took them so long?
I hope you don't mind if I duck that question, because I'm not buying it. I mean, I think this is more PR than anything. There's, in my opinion, no new suspect, and there will never be a new suspect unless and until the parents answer questions. Remember, Kate McCann, poor Madeleine's mom, refused to answer 48 questions.
Now, Wendy hired
a team of lawyers right away. But this is important. She refused right away to answer. She hired lawyers right away, refused to answer 48 questions. Things like, what did you see when you walked into the room where your child was supposed to be sleeping? I mean, I am so not interested in being dragged down a rabbit hole about fake suspects.
Now,
and I think this is all related to a civil suit now underway in Portugal. The McCann sued the former police chief for defamation.
Because he wrote
and now
this,
Kate
book,
wants,
this alleged tell-all book.
Yes.
But Wendy, hold on. Let me tell you the other side of this. Because there's a lot of evidence on the side of the parents being completely innocent as well. They say that the Portuguese police never took the case seriously. They never did the kind of investigation that we certainly would have done here in the United States, which is talking to other people at the vacation, where they were vacationing in Portugal. Furthermore, Kate and Jerry, the parents, have appealed to their country's prime minister, David Cameron, for help on this investigation. Is that something you do if you're trying to stay under the radar and you feel guilty?
Do you hire the nation's biggest defense attorneys, PR firms, and refused to answer questions? The Portuguese police did a very good job, and the PR misinformation, especially in this country, is doing a disservice to this poor little girl who is dead, I believe, and has no voice. The libel suit currently underway in Portugal is important because the McCanns sued that ex-police chief, claiming he lied about them in his book. Now Kate McCann wants to testify in writing because she doesn't want to submit to cross-examination. I think this is all related to that, and this whole we have a new suspect thing is part of them again trying to distract attention from the fact that as parents of a missing, probably dead child, what are you doing not answering questions?
Creshman served Scotland Yard's purposes. They had got rid of the embarrassing sighting by Jane Tanner, widely regarded as fabricated. Now they had got that out of the way, they could change the window of time during which the alleged abduction happened from 5 minutes to more like 50 minutes. And they had a brand new abductor, Smith Man. But in this film, we've traced this series of four alleged abductors and found all four with inconsistencies. First, we considered Sagres Man. We showed that the claim by Nuno Lorenco that Krakowski, on holiday from Poland for a week, had tried to snatch his daughter lacked credibility. It seemed he couldn't recall on what date it was supposed to have happened, and he didn't bother telling the police about it for days. We exposed the attempt to suggest that the McCanns were also in Sagres, and that Krakowski had seen Madeleine there as no more than a media invention, completely unsubstantiated. Then we saw the evidence that Jane Tanner's statement may have been fabricated and seemingly based on the same description that Nuno Lorenco gave about Krakowski. Next we saw that the sighting of Smith Man by the Irish family had numerous problems, not least why it took so long to report their sighting and the later enhancements to the sightings made by them or by others. Finally, we have examined the unlikely Creshman, which is a tale full of improbability and the most unlikely coincidences. Only one of these men has been proven to be real, and that is Sagres Man, the man described by Nuno Lorenco, and he was actually Wojciech Krakowski. Is it possible that Nuno Lorenco, primed by others, deliberately invented a tale about an attempted abduction of his daughter? Is it possible he told his unlikely tale to the Portuguese police on the morning after Jane Tanner described her sighting, in order to try to convince the police that there was an abductor? Especially when one considers all the evidence in my previous film, there probably never was an abductor at all. It certainly seems that way. Was the description of Smithman another fabrication, and why was it almost identical to the descriptions of Sagresman and Tannerman? After all, apart from these four alleged abductors, what other evidence of an abduction do we actually have? To my knowledge, there is none. In my previous film, we looked at some of the many contradictions and changes of story surrounding these claims. Apart from what the McCanns themselves say, what actual independent forensic evidence do we have of an abductor? Is there any forensic evidence, footprints, fingerprints, hairs, clothing fibres, DNA, anything in fact? It seems there is none. The only complete fingerprint found on the window was actually that of Kate McCann, suggesting that she may have been the last person to handle the window, sometime shortly before the police were called. Did anyone hear this mystery abductor, maybe lifting the shutters, entering or fleeing the building, the noise of a child, anything at all in fact? Again, absolutely nothing. I'm going to wrap up this film by stating that this video and my previous videos on this case have been made with almost zero funding. I would argue that I have exposed much of the disinformation and got closer to the truth about what really happened. I want you to compare my videos with the information you have seen put out by mainstream media, who have got almost limitless resources. Looking at what I have managed to uncover and put forward in these films as a one-man operation, it should have been fairly straightforward for mainstream media to do the same. It should have been easy for them to carry out investigative journalism and do a similar job to me. But I hope I have fully demonstrated that this is not what mainstream media are about. In fact, I would argue they have helped mislead and therefore hide and bury the true story of Madeleine McCann. Exercises like the Leveson Inquiry are no more than psychological operations to try and show the media are being brought to book. Nothing could be further from the truth. Thank you for watching, and please copy and distribute this film freely.